I want you to know that to my knowledge, we've had some wonderful members. We've had members to join our church. We have some good people. But to my knowledge, we've never had a member of the Wall Street Journal to be a part of our church. And to my knowledge, we've never had the Wall Street Journal here to interview me or our positions or anything. And yet, the Wall Street Journal has released an article by Jason Riley, and I've met Jason, but he's never been here. I don't know that Jason would remember me, but Jason Riley does an article. It's July the 10th, 2018. This article was released, and it's interesting. It says, as the Judge Brett Kavanaugh Supreme Court nomination tees up for another national debate about reproductive rights, is it too much to ask that abortion's impact on the black population be a part of the discussion? You know, in Atlanta last weekend, they had a discussion with presidential candidates who are running. I wonder if any of those preachers in Atlanta, the black church forum with the Democrats candidates, I wonder if a preacher in Atlanta, the preachers are supposed to represent our best interests, right? I wonder if one preacher in Atlanta asked those Democrat candidates, what impact has abortion and their position on abortion had on the black community? And ask them, where do you stand on that? Now, this is the Wall Street Journal. It says, when the Supreme Court decided Roe v. Wade in 1973, polling showed that blacks were less likely than whites to support abortion. 60s era civil rights activists like Fannie Lou Hamer and Whitney Young had denounced the procedure as a form of genocide. Jesse Jackson called abortion murder and once told a black newspaper in Chicago that, quote, we used to look for death from the man in the blue coat, and now it comes in a white coat. End of quote. In the intervening decades, those views shifted. Mr. Jackson announced the pro-life shift to run for president in 1984. And leaders of black civil rights organizations today are joined at the hip with abortion rights proponents such as Planned Parenthood. A Pew Research Center survey taken last year found that 50% of Hispanics, 58% of whites, and 62% of blacks now say abortion should be legal in all or most cases. In New York City, thousands more black babies are aborted than born alive each year. The abortion rate among black mothers is more than three times higher than it is for white mothers. According to a Health Department report, and the Health Department is not a part of Upper Room either. According to their report, released in May, between 2012 and 2016, black mothers terminated 136,426 pregnancies and gave birth to 118,127 babies. By contrast, births far far surpassed abortion among whites, Asians, and Hispanics. Nationally, black women terminate pregnancies at a far higher rate than other women as well. In 2014, 36% of all abortions were performed on black women, who are just 13% of the female population, and only 3% of that 13% are part of the ovulating population, because all black women can't have babies. Some are too old, some are too young. This is the ovulating population. The little discussed flip side of reproductive freedom is that abortion deaths far exceed those via cancer, violent crime, heart disease, AIDS, and accidents. Racism, poverty, lack of access to health care are the typical explanations for these disparities. But black women have much higher abortion rates, even after you can control for income. Moreover, other low-income ethnic minorities who experience discrimination, such as Hispanics, abort at a rate much closer to whites than black women. This is the Wall Street Journal, not Patrick Wooden. I'm just reading the news. There is a plan in place to kill us. And every politician, regardless to their party, who espouses a woman's right to choose, who is pro-abortion, is anti-black. And they are your true racists. Because if you don't have life, you don't have anything. Without life, there's nothing. I don't know why that is so hard to grasp, but it all starts with birth. And don't you let anyone, no matter what else they're for, if they're not for you being born, and they are in favor of policies that are killing us at a rate that's unlike anything that we've ever seen in America. I wish I could talk to Kamala Harris. I wish I could talk to Booker. I wish I could talk to Buttigieg. I wish I could talk to Elizabeth Warren Bernie Sanders, and all of them who are staunch supporters of the largest killer of African Americans that history has ever known. And it shakes them. It shakes them. It shakes the NAACP. It shakes the Urban League. It shakes all institutions when this truth is spoken to black folk, because all of a sudden, the dumbest black person knows that without life, there is nothing. You don't have to go to high school. You don't have to go to college. You don't have to have gone to Cambridge, Oxford, Notre Dame, NC State, Shaw, or anywhere to know that without life, there is nothing. And Patrick Wooden, Bishop Wooden, will continue. And I asked the rest of my preacher buddies online who, you guys, you get so fired up about everything. You post almost daily. You give a daily report. And some of you guys have gone to cussing and swearing yourselves. I wonder why aren't you, if you're gonna cuss and swear, How am I cussing and swearing? Now, I don't want to, you know, I'm not encouraging anybody to cuss and swear. But if you're just going to cuss and swear, if you're just going to do it anyway, how about cussing and swearing for us to be born? If you're just going to cuss and swear. Now, I'm not saying cuss and swear, but if you're just going to cuss and swear, you're going to cuss and swear about illegals coming into the country illegally and argue that that ought to be allowed and that's inhumane, but you're mute about the slaughter of your own. No other race of people does that. Nobody. How you gonna do that? You're quiet about the slaughter of your own. I have no respect for anyone who is quiet about the slaughter of their own. I'll give the mic to anyone who can explain it. Well, you know, we don't want people born in poverty. I was born in poverty. Most of us here were born in poverty. Jesus said, the poor you will have with you always. So if poverty is a reason for a person not to be born, then that's going to wipe out a whole lot of people. Well, we don't want hardship. I mean, who wasn't born? Birth is hardship. Say amen. No, it's a grand scheme. And the reason why his, I'm going to tell you, and I want this out there. The reason why Hispanics and Asians and others abort at a lesser rate is that they do not vote 90% one way like black people do. They actually hear the other side of the argument. They hear other stories. They hear other philosophies. Why didn't the preachers in Atlanta have this forum when the Republicans were running? Bring them in. Talk to them. It's two sides of an issue. Don't you be the kind of person who only listens to one side. That is our pattern, and in doing it, it's costing us dearly. I believe, in closing this, that blacks have a right to be born. If you believe me, show by a great round of applause. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just like everyone else. And also for those who are here today who have had an abortion, as we say all the time, we are not talking to you. We're not talking about you. If you've repented of your sins, the Lord has forgiven you. And if you haven't, repent and he will forgive you. Amen. And he'll wash you white as snow, and you're just as clean as anyone else, just because we're all forgiven. But we got to fight this slaughter, y'all. And you got to say amen for me when we fight the slaughter, or there won't be enough of us left to fight. Amen.